Started. As always, brief agenda. I think we'll give you a small intro into the community for folks who are joining in new. Hand it over then to Akash to give us an intro into our speaker's profile. I think most of y'all already know him, but a brief intro into his profile. Then we'll be handing it over to Pulkit to walk us through his journey, and he has a nice slide deck for us understanding the entire product journey as well as, you know, the Vedanta story. Then we move on to the regular Q&A. That is the one that we crowdsource from you all, as well as some that Akash and me were brainstorming. And in case you have any other questions, feel free to put it in the Q&A section, and we'll hope to pick it up towards the end in case we have more time. So yeah, without further ado, let's get started. The Product Folks is a volunteer-driven community of product managers and product enthusiasts. We've done about 100+ events in the last 1 year. And slowly been building out small resources for the product community. I think learnpmwith.me was one such resource, which is a curated set of, it's free, it's online, it's a curated set of resources for you to help you upskill into the space of product management. We have insurgo.club, which is an early stage APM program. We've just about announced another initiative called 100 PMs, where we're trying to get mentors on board. And yeah, another exciting announcement coming up next. So do stay tuned. Without further ado, I think jumping right into today's session, Akash, over to you to introduce our speaker for today.
Yeah, thank you so much, Suhas. I'm pretty excited about this as well. All of you guys can actually see Pulkit on call today. And just to give a brief introduction about Pulkit, Pulkit is actually an alum of IIT Roorkee. And I think he spent a very, very brief period, like most of us working in companies, but you know, immediately jumped to entrepreneurship right away. He started with Lakshya initially, and with his friends from college, of course. And after that, he started with Vedantu, right? Both Laksh and Vedantu were in the tech space. And the mission of Vedantu as of today is, you know, making education accessible to even the remotest parts of the country, right? That's been the core mission. And I'm very excited to see how exactly they are, you know, staying on course, this particular mission, right? So Pulkit, please feel free to, you know, take it away from here.
Sure. Thanks a lot. Akash, Suhas, and the entire the Product Folks team for having me over. And I'll guys, all of you, great to have all of you here. Saturday ko finding time is not easy, I know. And it really shows that, you know, you all really want to, you know, learn something. And I'll try my best to give whatever that I can in this session through my journey, right? Chalo yaar, shuru karte hai. So how I will do it? I will try to take you through my journey. So guys, just to set the context, as Akash said, I have very less corporate experience. I graduated in 2005. Way back. And after working for 5-6 months, yaar bilkul figure out nahi ho raha tha. I actually got into a sort of a consulting firm. The friends in Roorkee, and Vamsi was in IIT Bombay, who's my co-founder. And we were in different companies, but we were really lost, frankly. And 2005 was a very different time. There was no tech ecosystem in the country. Entrepreneurship was unheard of. Venture capital and all those things were again unheard of. Somehow, all of us went to a very small place where two of us were working. So Anand and Saurabh, my co-founders, they were working in a small chemical plant in Punjab, which that chemical plant sort of lured these talented IIT grads to work in a chemical plant in a very small village in Punjab. We went to these two guys, one thing led to another, and we ended up in a Kendriya Vidyalaya, just outside the factory premise where factory worker kids used to study, right? And you know what, my conversation with those kids, in fact, all of our conversation with those kids was path breaking. So let me start my journey from there. Let me share my screen as well. I hope you can see, right? Yeah, so
yep.
So that's how my journey started, right? How? By talking with these young kids, and all that we could talk to those young kids in those times was that, you know, kids, being from small places doesn't mean that you should feel that you're at loss. Children from small places do great in life. Because, you know, we realize that children are very underconfident. in that small village, Barnala, where we were at that time, right? As you were exploring. So when we motivated those kids, we were pretty sincere in our talk, right? But when we saw a few tears rolling in those young eyes, so I mean, we were overwhelmed. In our 22 years of life till then, we had never had such an overwhelming experience ever. And I fondly remember next day, 13th of December 2005, Anand, my co-founder, who was working in the factory there, at morning 7 a.m. he sort of woke up and said, "Yar, main to nahi ja raha. I'm not going to factory. You guys see what you want to do." And that's how the journey started. We started visiting lots of schools nearby in that region. None of us is from Punjab, by the way. Vamsi, in fact, is from South India. I'm from Rajasthan. Saurabh was from the Central India. Anand was from Bihar. So, but somehow, you know, we really loved being there, loved talking to those young kids. And then we started teaching them formally in a brick and mortar physical institutional setup. We started calling Laksh, and it was all an experiment in our minds, right? So these were my partners in crime. So Vamsi, the leftmost, then me, Anand, Saurabh, and amazing days. Those are really, really amazing days. And you know what? Luckily in those days, the thoughts of venture capital, scale, the glamour of entrepreneurship, as a lot of people see, you know, was not the factors at all. And that was so pure and so beautiful in those days. Because the only factor which was sort of pushing us to do something was our being together, that joy of friendship. And the second thing was, you know, the fun of being with these young kids. This was so amazing. Absolutely no other parameter. And I really, truly, you know, treasure those days today as well. So we started teaching kids there. But what happened there was, you know, amazing. In the very first year, in that small place, Patiala, where we had started Laksh, my first venture in education, we had 33 kids in the very first year in class 12th, I remember. And out of those 33, 35 odd kids, you know, these were the kids who had not prepared for any competitive exams in their class 11th. Patiala was a sleepy town, you know, chal raha hai aaram se life, koi tension nahi hai type of town. But after studying for 1 year, very interestingly, 11 kids out of those 33, 35 odd kids got into these top 3,000 ranks in IITs. And you're like surprised. Yare, kaise ho sakta? How can that happen? I mean, I still remember that I must have taught a few math concepts wrong in that first year. So what is leading to this phenomenal success ratio, right? The selection ratio in the country for everybody's reference is less than a percent, right? Much less than a percent. So ye kaise ho gaya? How did this happen? We thought it might have been a fluke. We kept on teaching kids. But you know, the percentage selection ratio always kept upwards of 25%. And then we started thinking, what should I give attribution to this phenomenal success in the selection ratios to? And the only difference that we could find in those days was our being teachers by choice. And why am I telling you this story? Because this is pivotal in everything that we have done since then till Vedantu today. All of these have very, very important learnings for us, right? So teachers by choice became a very important, you know, a guiding light for us, which still remains a guiding light for Vedantu. Mere t-shirt ke piche teachers by choice likha hai. So this is what is written behind my t-shirt as well. So guys, just think about this. People like you, people like me, right? People like you and me, we don't become teachers, right? Even if I ask you to become a teacher, you'll be like, what, teacher? Teacher kaun banta yaar? Chalo, even if some of you actually become teacher, will you actually go to a small place like a Bhatinda or a Patiala, a tier 4 kind of a town in the country? Unlikely, very unlikely, right? But this is what led to tremendous impact in those young lives in that small place. And you know, over the years, we attracted more people like us. For example, I still remember the first teacher who joined us beyond us for teaching was Harpreet. Here, Harpreet, yahan pe. Can you see the third here in the fourth image? So Harpreet was Vamsi's batchmate from IIT Bombay. He was working with NVIDIA Graphics in San Francisco. He was visiting India. He visited us and then he stayed back. And all the folks that you see in the pictures here, all of these guys had left their jobs, cushy jobs, to take a very conscious choice, a call of becoming a teacher. But that led to tremendous impact. That small place, Patiala, by 2009-10 had completely transformed. If selections are a parameter of success, which we strongly believe are not, but still to give you an idea, that small place, Patiala, was producing 90 to 100 selections in top 3,000 ranks in IITs, 3 to 4 selections in AIIMS, multiple medals in international maths, physics, chemistry, biology, Olympiads. I mean, people were dreaming big. So then we expanded. So then we started expanding. Over the years, Laksh expanded, over the next 2 years, expanded to, you know, places like Bhatinda, Panchkula, Zirakpur, Chandigarh. So a lot of those small places in Punjab, Haryana built. And by 2012, Laksh had become one of the biggest brands upwards of Delhi, NCR region. So Jammu, Punjab, Haryana, a lot of, you know, thousands of students used to come to study with us. Laksh was a 200 member team. But now comes the problem statement, guys. Now, but before that, I would love to, you know, share a few stories with you to give you the sense of impact that amazing teaching and education system creates in such small places. I fondly remember a few of these kids who I'm in touch with today as well. So Ayush, I'm really fond of this guy. He came to us in 2006, my first batch. Went to IIT Roorkee. Ye Bangalore ki photo hai, 2013-14 ki, when all these old kids were in Bangalore. So here, Ayush in the center. So Ayush, over the years, filed for multiple patents in complex optics, struggled hard for 4 or 5 years in building multiple products. Eventually, he created a product a hardware which you can put behind any mobile phone, and using the complex optics and the algorithm that his team has written, that urine strip for pregnancy test can be inserted in that hardware, and their product can do the pregnancy test as well as, you know, entire hormone profile of any woman. Amazing product. Went to Y Combinator, I think 2 years back. He was also Forbes 30 under 30 last year, last year, 2019. Last year. So amazing story, right? From small place, Patiala, this kid. Now look at this guy. I'm very fond of this guy, this is Apaksh. Apaksh didn't go to IIT. So this also is very important for all of us to understand. Success is not about getting into these top colleges. So this kid was so hardworking, you know, did tons of startups. I think 5 startups in 5 years. Eventually, he started one of the world's biggest influencer network. And he was Forbes 30 under 30 last year. Uttam came from a very small place in Haryana, went to do his PhD in UNSW. He was the brand ambassador of Government of Australia 2 years back for higher education, right? So such amazing stories were getting created from those small places. Now that led to the big question in front of me, that was, yaar, how to scale this impact? So why should this impact be limited to places like the Patiala, Bhatinda, these small places? How can I go to every small place of the country? And by then it was very clear in my mind that brick and mortar setup cannot be scaled to every small place in the country. So let us put the problem statement at the center. Problem statement was, I clearly understood the role of a great teacher in small kids' life, right? That is a K-12. K-12 kid, that is kindergarten to 12, right? Guys, is my voice cracking? I just saw the chat. Am I audible now?
Yeah, I think it's fine. We're checking with the team. So I think you can continue.
It's good. Okay. Yeah. Okay, I see your messages as well. The chat is in front of me. All right, guys. So first, how do we get best of the society to become teacher? Problem statement one. And if they become teacher, how do I give their access, or how do I take these awesome teachers to every small place in the country, every small village in the country? This is the problem. And this cannot happen in offline setup. So I still very fondly remember that incident. The mother of a teacher who was in Bhatinda, our Bhatinda center in Punjab, she called me very angry. She was very angry one night and she called me, ki Pulkit, aapne mere bete ko kahan bhej diya? Where have you sent my young boy to? I'm finding it so difficult to marry him. Nobody's ready to marry him. He's a teacher. Second, he's in Bhatinda. You know, it was very clear to me that this model cannot scale. So that is when I shifted to Bangalore in 2012. And that is when the journey of Vedantu starts. So I thought that, you know, maybe technology will have some solution. So we decided that one of us can go and explore. So I came to Bangalore in 2012. And journey after that is of tons of pivots. So guys, by the way, what is Vedantu? So the name, it's a very weird name. I found it very weird when I started. Meaning is Ved Tantu. Ved means knowledge in Sanskrit. And Tantu, wo bolte na Hindi mein, Tantu jagrat ho gaye. I don't know how many of you understand Hindi. So Tantu means sort of neural network, sort of threads or network. So that was the whole idea. But I really didn't know what to do. Absolutely clueless. So I came to Bangalore, got two young talented guys from IIT Roorkee who had built a nice Quora-like platform in campus. I got these two folks along with me and we started iterating. And then started the journey of pivots. So mujhe frankly kuch samajh mein nahi aa raha tha. I was totally clueless. And I started building whatever I could, think. So the first product that we built actually was this. It became a B2B product from 2012 to 14. What got created was a B2B product, which, you know, anybody in the any educational body could use it to create their own educational apps, custom labeled educational apps on click of a button, mobile ready, very detailed content management and distribution system behind it, social layer, so on and so forth. Tons of technology. But in 2014, I realized, why on earth am I doing it? How is it solving the core problem? Maybe I got lost in the process. Maybe I was coming from a bootstrap background and I didn't understand the investment ecosystem. So maybe my first line of attack was, let's do B2B, because there was some revenue in B2B that I could understand in those days, right? But in 14, when we realized that this is not solving the problem, we were a 5-6 member team. In a CCT, we all sat together and we decided, bhai, nahi ho raha. This is not going the right direction. We ended up giving the source code to all the people who were using us, all the big institutions who were using us. And then the thought of live teaching and learning started emerging in our minds. So guys, how that idea came? I still remember we used to use those colored markers on the white tables in our small office that we had. So suddenly we realized, why can't we sort of replicate this behavior where a child and a teacher could sit across the table with a shared notebook and a book between them? Yeah, theoretically it solves the problem. How amazing is that? You know, all of us have been elder sisters and the brothers and have taught our younger brothers and sisters across the table. Can I replicate this? And the teacher and the child can be in any part of the world. But the live in 2014 was sort of unheard of. So we're pretty confused. So that is when our first product happened. The first product was the one-to-one teaching learning platform. And the hypothesis, and we sort of started it like a Uber Black approach, where we thought, forget about the revenue. Let us first see if it works. We had tons of fundamental questions in our mind. You know the kind of questions we had in our mind in those days? Are there teachers who can teach online? Are there tools available to teach online? Since we are fixated on the person of teacher, that is teachers by choice, people like you and me, best of the society, will the payouts be enough, sufficient for them to sustain on such a platform respectfully? Will parents sort of trust something like this for something as mission critical as education? Will the children ask a doubt or will they learn the entire curriculum? Will they learn it on a desktop or on a mobile? Is bandwidth an issue? I'm talking about a pre-Jio, pre-4G era, right? So tons of questions. But very interestingly, majority of these questions sort of got answered satisfactorily by 2015 mid. And what we evolved as a marketplace of teachers. So list of teachers, imagine a list of teachers where you could see their ratings, reviews, go purchase their hours, then do everything automatically. Schedule, reschedule, cancel, whatever, content sharing. So that was our product one, the first product. But suddenly two problems emerged. So again, pivots. Problem one, we became an affluent family phenomenon. So in fact, by the end of 15, majority of the families on the platform were not from India. Sabse pehle kaun aaya? The first people who came to us were sort of, you know, the senior directors or the Flipkart kind of folks, the VCs, whose children were in 9th and 10th grades. That is what we launched with. No test prep, because we realized that test prep is mission critical. Nobody will trust something new. So we absolutely didn't touch test prep at that time. Through their word of mouth came their relatives in Middle East and US. And they came in hordes. So in fact, 70% of the families on the platform by end of 15 were from, you know, Dubai, Qatar, Doha, Saudi Arabia, San Francisco, New York, Malaysia, Singapore. So garbad ho gaya yaar. This is not what you wanted to do. We wanted to go to village and we went to Dubai. This is a something, this is not what I wanted to solve for, right? So pivot number one is one to many. The second problem was marketplace. I was not very convinced with the marketplace approach because, you know, in education, think about this. I gave you teacher, you're a child, and then I said, dude, whatever you want to learn, you learn. Are? In all my journey, I realized that a young kid, he or she doesn't actually know what he or she wants to learn, in what way, right? And learning is not on demand, right? So learning is, for a young kid, you need to curate a learning journey. You need to ensure that the kid moves in that learning journey in the best possible way. And you intervene at the right point, at the right stage, to ensure that the child keeps moving in that learning journey in an inspired way, right? So marketplace approach is not that. So this is the second pivot, third pivot rather, from marketplace to institutional. That is, if you can see the image here, today at Vedantu, we do everything from live classes to post-class content to test to doubt solving to parent-teacher meetings to student communities to the personalized interventions to each and every child, sort of surgical strike on every child. Power. Himanshu is asking me, how did I survive all these pivoting? I'm sure it would be really hard. How did we, you can ask my family, trust me. So pivoting is never easy. And, but you know, I always, I feel fortunate that, you know, it's one singular problem that we have been trying to solve. So, you know, if you feel attached and if you really feel passionate to solve a problem, now, all these small things don't deter you. I don't have a very deep answer for, I cannot talk for everyone. For me, that deep passion to solve this problem maybe kept me going. But yeah, trust me, pivoting and building companies is, you know, the toughest thing to do in emotionally. And if you have a family, trust me, they will want to kill you one day. So for that, anyways, jokes apart. But all of you, all the ones who really want to do, a startup or anything, please keep these factors in mind. Nothing that you think or any idea that you think, you know, will work as soon as you launch the startup will definitely not work. You will always go through tons of pivots, tons and tons of pivots. You know, all these ideas are ideas. Execution is the key. And when you start executing, you realize what you think is exactly not how people behave or what people expect. That's your fantasies, that's your fascinations, not the reality at times. So don't, be very, very sort of possessive about your ideas. Let them iterate, let them, you know, evolve over the time. Anyways, so let's move ahead. So guys, then, you know, this is the mission statement, which has always been that, you know, how can we provide 10x better teaching? At Vedantu, we were providing great teaching in our opinion, but first, it wasn't at the quarter of a cost. Second, it wasn't scalable. So if I'm using technology, so how can I make it 10x better, but at the same time, affordable and accessible so that it can reach every child in the country, right? So that is what we wanted to do. Yes, Shetaja, I'll try to take that question. I'm seeing your question in the chat. Sorry, there is a Q&A panel as well, guys. Let me just quickly go through the questions in Q&A panel because I'm only looking at the chat till now.
Pulkit, we thought we'll get through the deck and then pick it up
Achha,
towards
okay.
the end.
Okay, okay, fine. I think I'll do that.
बहुत सारे क्वेश्चन आते रहेंगे.
ठीक है, ठीक है. Cool, guys. ठीक है. So now let's come to the product approach, guys. So now we have come to the Vedantu story. We have gone through two pivots. One is to one, seven to many, from marketplace to institutional. Now let's try to talk about the approaches. So how do I do a group class was a big problem in my mind. So in 2016, when we started pivoting from one is to one to one to many, in my mind it was very difficult because group class kaise karenge yaar? How do we do group class? I have come from a offline teaching experience and I have been a student myself. All of you, just close your eyes and imagine a wonderful class. A classroom is such a soulful experience in an ideal world, right? You come to a class because there's a lot of love and respect for the teacher. You don't come just to learn Newton's law. You come there because you have your friends there, right? You ask doubts in the class. Your doubts get answered in real time inside the class. As a teacher, teacher sees the faces and the expressions of each and every child. Teacher accordingly iterates her pace and level of teaching. At times, there is a chalk that a teacher can throw at a child to nudge him or her. At times, the teacher stops and inspires kids, right? But how will that happen in a group setup, in a digital world, where everybody like in this session, in this Zoom session, is sitting behind their screens? I can't see you, right? Mujhe Akash aur Suhas dikh rahe hai bas yahan pe, right? So how will this class happen, right? And if it is not interactive, then to video kar lo yaar, what is the whole point of doing a live class, right? So that was a big problem in my mind. In my mind, I wanted the classes to be engaging, interactive and fun. So that is where a lot of iterations over the next 2 years happened. So again, the problem was we were the only ones thinking about it, doing it at that time, and that wasn't easy. I didn't have any examples to look up to. So we evolved. Over the next 1.5 to 2 years, we did tons of experiments around, different batch sizes, different pedagogy, different content styles, different persona of teachers, different platform types, and we were evolving in our mind. So the teaching style and the platform approach that we evolved with was that we tried making content extremely interactive. So imagine children interacting with the class and with the content every few minutes, right? And all these interactions in the background become the data layer for us, which helps, right, our teacher understand the sentiment of the class and of the individual children. There are mechanisms in the class to solve doubts in real time. And there were lots of experiments which happened around that. Right. So the platform which we have evolved with is today what we call as Wave. It's a very funny name. It's whiteboard audio video environment, but Wave sort of sounds cool. So we call it Wave. That's our group live learning platform. Right. I'll go in a bit of depth. So idea was to make concept teaching fun and interactive. Right. So as you can see in the chat, right, the class are very interactive. The children love it. They love our teachers. The person of teachers is phenomenal. This Vani ma'am. So Vani ma'am, she's a doctor, right? She's an army wife. I know Vani for the last 12 years now. I'm just giving you the person of our teachers. So Vani was posted, her husband was posted at Bhutan border. She started teaching from there. And today, Vani, I think every month she touches few million kids on the platform. So this is the power of technology, right? There is a continuous feedback in the class, right? So I'll give you some examples. When I will also give example of how my being a teacher and our being teacher actually helped us create the product. So let's take an example. When I used to teach in an offline world, I used to ask questions like, "Achha, bachcho, batao, abhi polygon padha hai na apne, we have just read polygon. So tell me square and rhombus, which has equal diagonals." If majority of my class used to say rhombus, I used to be like, "Arre, bachcho kahan tak gaye? Where are you stuck? Let me repeat it. I think you are stuck somewhere, right?" The correct answer is square, of course. So, but how do I do it in the online world? So we evolved with lots of interactions. We sort of invented lots of interactions. So one of those interactions is what we call as hotspot. For example, imagine the teacher could make any part of the screen clickable in real time. So imagine I'm teaching you and I suddenly make rectangle and rhombus clickable. And, you know, suddenly all of you click it. And I'm like, wow, 90% of you say rectangle. Kya baat hai yaar? Bahut sahi hai. 10% of you quickly ask your doubts. Now the doubt asking. So the class is actually broken down into, you know, multiple sections. So doubt. Imagine there are 200 kids in the class, but these 200 kids are actually broken down into different sections. Each section, multiple teacher assistants are there who are solving their individual doubts in those respectable sections, right? And a lot of these doubts then are surfaced to the main teacher as well, who then broadcasts the doubt and discusses with the entire class. But guys, in this entire process, remember, every doubt is captured by the system, right? Every click is captured by the system. System knows which child clicked rectangle, which child clicked rhombus. This is a phenomenal data layer for Vedantu, right? And there are tons of other engagements. So class is super interactive. So children are clicking, asking, you know, speaking. A lot of things are happening inside the class, and which from a teacher perspective is becoming the eyes and the ear and the senses for the teacher to iterate the class, right? There is a lot of gamification inside the class. For example, look at the screen right now. So there are lots of quizzes, pre-curated quizzes inside the class, right? There are lots of, you know, gamification, leaderboards, reward system inside the class. So children love it. Children just totally love it. And all these things, as I said, are leading to a very important question, which is the core of the philosophy at Vedantu. So I'll tell you what is the core of question for audience. Does Pulkit still take classes? Okay, batao bhai, do I still take classes? Yeah. So, acha. So the important question in my mind in 2016 was, which today is the core of the Vedantu product philosophy. I was struggling with this question that, yes, Hari, I do take class. This is my best time when I take classes, right? Product banane se bhi maza aata hai zyada class lene mein, trust me. So the question in my mind was, all of you just think about this. In the entire human history, the teaching learning engagement had always been very, very subjective. Imagine all of you, when you used to go to class, for example, when Seher, Abhishek, Ritika, Abhishek, Suhas, when all of you used to go to classes and when you used to come back home, right? Your mother used to ask you questions like, beta, how was your class? Theek hai? Aaj kaisa padhaya teacher ne? How did the teacher teach today? Did you enjoy? And our answers used to be, yeah, ma, okay, good, boring, right? Some subjective statements. But now that is a problem. In the entire human history, we could never mathematically measure what happened inside a teaching learning engagement. But it was very, very critical in my mind because, see, we're talking about 250 plus million kids in the country. If Vedantu or any education platform has to teach them, but as I said, the philosophy is teaching them predictably. Look, teaching to hum YouTube pe bhi kar rahe. So for example, at Vedantu last month itself, more than 15 million students watched our classes on YouTube. That is teaching, right? But I really didn't know. I really don't know what happened to those kids. Did they really enjoy? Did they understand? What was their learning outcome? I don't know. But at Vedantu, in our platform, the approach is we have to teach these kids with utmost predictability of learning outcome. We want mathematical precision in our ability to measure and ensure that the learning outcome happens for all these kids, not just the top ranks, not just the marks, right? So that is important, but how do I do it without measuring what happens inside the class? So we use data to find answers to questions like, how engaged was, for example, Akash inside the class? At what point in the class when a particular concept was being taught, how engaged was he? Was his engagement going up or down inside the class? Across the classes, with different teachers, with respect to other students, with respect to him, himself? How effective was the content? How do I know was the content effective or not? I remember my professors they have been teaching for the last 15, 20 years with the same, you know, papers, with the same notes. Was it really effective? How do I measure it? How effective was the teacher? How do I even measure the effectiveness of a teacher? His, hand gestures, his emotions, his expressions, was he speaking loudly or calmly? Was he speaking fast or slow? Was he writing? How was his handwriting? Was he writing when he was speaking? There are tons of these parameters, right, which come together to create a great teacher. But can I measure it? Can I measure the learning outcome of each and every child in real time inside the class? So all those things are very important, right? So with this hypothesis, we sort of, you know, filed our first set of patents, I remember. So in 2016, we were a small team, but luckily I had access to my old students from Laksh days who were in great colleges by then. So three students came to us. We together wrote algorithms to measure all these things, which I just talked about, right? Using all the data that we had. And we filed, you know, some 22 claims, I remember, as patents in India and US. I was really surprised when all of our claims got granted in the US. So this really tells us that there's so much research that needs to go to make teaching and learning, and in fact, the entire learning process, a very predictable experience and a very personalized experience for each and every child, right? We have just scratched the surface. All these digital platforms like Vedantu are, in my mind, the step in the right direction, because we not just teach or deliver content, but we today can also measure how child, you know, engages with it. And if we can measure it, then probably we can also do the right intervention in the process, in the right way, in the personalized way for each and every child, right? So this is the approach that we are taking. And every part that we do today, so Vedantu is a very comprehensive learning system today, not just a live class. So live classes, post-class content. If I know so much about a child inside the class, should I give the same assignment to every child? No. So a lot of, you know, personalization, adaptiveness, the testing, be it subjective, be it objective, round-the-clock doubt solving. Do we really need humans to solve the doubts in the class and outside the class if we have so much of data? Are the kind of problems that we are trying to solve today, right? Personalized interventions, right? So as I said, when I used to teach at Laksh, we used to solve so many problems for these kids because we were bachelors, some way better at the center, right? And the kids used to be with us till night. We used to solve so many problems, like the relationship issues. I was surprised that, you know, in teenage, there's so much relationship issues. Hamare sab to bhai nahi kabhi. So lots of such issues, from, you know, parental issues, relationship issues, academic issues. Sir, maine to chemistry ki nahi, so on and so forth, right? So lots of those kind of issues. But can we do the right intervention for each child at the right point? Data is super critical, right? So theoretically, if you see, Vedantu today covers the entire, everything that can happen in learning journey happens at Vedantu. But the journey ahead is, how can we use all these insights to do the right thing for the child? But everything at scale, not at a boutique level, right? Using this, what has happened over the years, from being a one-to-one, today we are really massively one-to-many, but it is our NPS has stayed, almost the NPS of one-to-one, the one-to-many NPS has almost stayed there. And today I know kids studying from, you know, I know kids from Andaman Nicobar Islands, I know kids from Baramulla in Kashmir. I was talking to a kid recently, he's from Rudraprayag in Uttarakhand, a small hill in Uttarakhand, near Tehri. So kids from these small places are able to learn on the platform today, which is amazing. Okay, yeah, Akash. Lots of amazing stories here. Would love to show you a story, actually. Let me just show you a story. 1 second, just give me a moment. Let's see if it works. See if you guys can see this. So it's a very nice story, which gives you, you know, how education really transformed these young lives.
Being at the remote area, I have missed this quality education. I was just helpless in those exams, competitive exams. My teachers look at me with a doubt of whether he will pass the exam or not. People from here, need to travel at least 90 kilometers from here, that is to Trichy, to attend some competitive exams. But even some competitive exams are not available in Trichy, so we need to go to Chennai, which is 300 kilometers from here. My friends used to go a lot of far distance, around 100 kilometers, to get education which is focused on academic only. I think that my Vedanta teachers know a lot more than my school teachers, because my school teachers are limited to the knowledge that is within my area. Online coaching will bring us to a variety of teachers who know knowledge from different parts of the country. Even when it takes disconnection, it would not be a big problem, because Vedanta has the convenience of free place. And the other tuition fees is double when compared to Vedanta. If we are going to an offline tuition, we need to travel, which will consume time. Twice the whole time for going and coming. But in online tuition, we can learn in our comfort in the homes. Teachers itne dedicated, itne hardworking, aur itne best hai ki wo raat ke 11:30 baje tak bhi aapko teaching kar dete hain. Haan, jab Vedant ko we can't even imagine that they can be qualified for JEE. It really changed his life. Because many doubts were there, which he was not even clear. And when Vedant to online classes, every day he was attending all the classes and he got all the doubts clear. If there is any doubt which he saw, he was putting it and getting that answer also within a one day or maybe next week. And so he was very happy. And as a parent, we were also very happy when he got selected in JEE.
So yeah, I hope you could see that.
Yep.
Cool. So that was the whole thing, guys. Almost this is all that I actually wanted to share. Lots of challenges ahead as well as we go ahead. I'll take your doubts. But yeah, some things that, you know, we are grappling with is how do we build up? Is, say, Vedantu or online learning completely predictable today? Far from it. You know, we have just scratched the surface. So how can we make it very, very predictable? See, we are a service. We are not a product that we sell and we run out, right? So Vedantu is in the business of educating children, and children attend the classes every day. They interact with the system every day, right? It is a service. How do we ensure that the service delivery is super predictable at the kind of scale that we are seeing today? Is a big, big challenge ahead. A lot of automations, a lot of thinking about removing humans from the picture or increasing the impact of every human being with the power of technology. That's a core technology challenge, right? That's why AI and ML are very, very important aspects going ahead. Keeping values intact as organization scales. So we are proud of our being teachers. We are proud of our being, you know, very student focused. But how do we keep these values intact as we scale, as new people join in? Easier said than done, and that too doing it in the COVID times when we are not meeting each other. Matlab, bure hal. So I'm sure all of you are grappling with this, right? And our DNA is evolving. We have been 0-1 company till now because we had to build a lot of stuff which didn't exist before, right? So from there, how do we also go towards building okay, I was just seeing the chat. So how do we, you know, organize ourselves for 1 to 100 kind of scale, right? It's a very different companies. A company geared for 0-1 and a company geared for 1 to 100 are very, very different, right? And many of you come from those great organizations which has seen 1 to 100 scale, right? Lots of companies that you talked about in your introductions. So that is the big challenge for us. And the biggest challenge for all you product folks, guys, is, you know, how do we build soulful experiences? See, imagine I have a problem that, you know, bacche assignments nahi attend karte. Children don't attend the assignments. And I, as a product guy, I can build a nice flow and say, are, I built such a nice flow. Everything is clear. It comes just after this and that. It's available on mobile and everything. But it's transactional. A child doesn't do it just because it is surfaced to you. A child does something because there is a reason he feels for doing it. There's inspiration that a child needs to get, right? There is a lot of factors which come together emotionally and psychologically for a child, for him or her to do something, I call it soulful. So how can we build product which is soulful and which is not transactional is a million-dollar question, right? It's easier said than done. And in the ecosystem, we all have built a lot of e-commerce and everything where, you know, the demand actually is of building a lot of transactional flows and nothing against it, right? But in education, it's slightly different. And we're talking about very young kids. Today, Vedantu teaches kindergarten to 12. When I go to kindergarten to 5, man, my kid, I have a 6-year-old, he studies on Vedantu. Building product for them is insane, right? Keeping them engaged is a different problem altogether. So very interesting problems ahead, really inspired, really excited. But yeah, as always, lots of unknowns. Yeah. Yep. I'll open it up to your questions. I think I spoke a lot. Sorry.
No worries at all. I think Pulkit, that was amazing. I think it was glad to hear on the surface how you've been thinking about building the company, the pivots, the challenges that you shared with. I think in our Q&A, we're going to dig deeper into the product side of things and also to understand, dig deeper into, I think, the entire company aspect, how you've gone about starting up. So yeah, just kicking off, I think we have a bunch of questions curated, like I mentioned, and then into the Q&A.
So should we take the questions?
We'll start with the ones that we got earlier while the registrations were going on from the community, and then we'll take the live ones.
Yes.
Yeah, that's actually right. Yeah, thanks, Suhas. Thanks, Pulkit. That was actually a really amazing session. So we got a bunch of questions. We knew that time wouldn't be sufficient because it's a great story that you just mentioned. So we curated it and we have a few questions here, right? So I'll start off with one that is in a way generic before we move into the deeper questions. So essentially the question is that, you know, when you are from a top college from the country, you generally have this mindset that you have to go to bigger organizations as such, right? It can be peer pressure, it can be your parents, it can just be your thought process as well. But when you were 22, I know you did speak about passion, but I really want to understand what exactly was your thought process at that particular time.
So Akash, frankly speaking, you know, I don't want to sound very smart by saying that I thought a lot. Frankly, my lack of parameters ahead of me, in front of me, was very helpful in, you know, for me to take a decision. So frankly, I didn't think about, you know, scale, entrepreneurship, glamour, or all those aspects, which are the things today, right? The only factors were about, you know, doing something which I really feel for. And luckily, it's not easy. But you know, that conversation with those young kids was really helpful in that. It was life-changing moment for me. But trust me, doing it alone, I'm sure I wouldn't have done it alone. So, you know, when you have these three friends together, and when recently Dil Chahta Hai movie had come, and we had been to Goa a couple of times in the last 2 years, and you are dreaming 22-year-olds, you know, these things happen very easily, frankly. So if I'm to take the same step today, pretty tough. So all of you with so much awareness around, pretty tough. So one suggestion for all of you, if you really feel for something, trust me, all of you are super talented. There is no dearth of opportunities. You know, trying out something in life which you feel for, is you're not going to lose anything. There is no loss at all. So do it, try it out. But don't do it for wrong reasons, like glamour, like money, like being your own boss. These are not the reasons to become an entrepreneur at all. You will not be able to sustain it, frankly.
So Pulka, just to add to that, in the beginning, was money or building a business not on your mind at all? Yes, impact and passion is something that is super important, agreed. But is that something that you were not thinking at all?
Sorry, I lost your question. Mayank ka dekh raha tha, bada interesting tha. Mayank, yaar, chemical mein toh meri job lagti nahi, frankly. So I got a job in consulting, but yeah, very valid point, Mayank. Yeah, guys, sorry, I lost you.
Just to close Akash's question, and maybe just to add to what you meant, was you are from a top college. A lot of people today from there get into good jobs. was money not a factor at all? Impact and scale, definitely. I think that is something all entrepreneurs pitch. But sabka psychologically, there is a driving factor, right? So how do you suggest a lot of people who want to break into startups? Impact and passion, yes, definitely. But what's so, beyond that?
See, frankly, you know, to try out your idea, you don't need a lot of money, right? For example, I'll tell you, my first year, we did lots of random hacks. So the company, the chemical plant where Anand and Saurabh were working, you know, we went to the owner of that chemical plant and we got our first check of 5 lakh rupees for him. So we just said that, you know, sir, we are totally inspired. We actually were inspired by him. Sir, we inspired. You are entrepreneur. We also want to be. So you give please. So he ended up giving us 5 lakh rupees. I ended up taking loan from so many of my friends. My wife was working in Schlumberger. She was not my wife at that time, but she was earning, you know, shitloads of money from my perspective. Usne bhi de diye paise. So, you know, you find ways. Don't think that raising money is the only way to try out anything that you want, right? Or see, kya hoga? Max, you'll lose 2 years, right? You'll again come back to the job market. It's and today companies, you know, companies like Vedantur, any company gives a lot of preference to anybody who has entrepreneurial experience, right? So there is nothing to lose, trust me. So one, so just to summarize, don't worry about venture capital. Don't take venture capital till you have really, you know, crystallized your thoughts and your ideas and found at least some hint of product market fit. Why do you want to burn someone else's money unnecessarily, right?
Got it. Makes sense.
And then go ahead with it.
Yeah. Yep. Since we are on this topic, we had a question later on in the session, but I'll just bring it up since we're on this topic exactly. Test prep market is huge, $45 billion market. Yeah. I'm pretty sure starting May, even if you started as a service, early days, Lakshika days, there was enough cash flow coming. So what is the entire story behind you raising venture capital? So you mentioned right now that venture capital ke bare mein zyada sochne ka hai nahi apne ko. But what is that? How did you guys think about it? Because people raise money either to, you know, capital intensive products rehte ya growth scale mein. So is it that transition that led to you all? Or because a lot of we know a lot of these big Fiji hair bunsels and a lot of these, it's a huge market. Yes. And each student, per student, they're paying a lot of money, right? So how did that
economy? Laksh was a bootstrap business for us. Okay. So Laksh was, I think by the time 2012, it was like a $7-8 million business.
How many of y'all were there in running that?
Hum log ka total team size, I think, was around 150 to 200 by 2012. Nice. And we're profitable, using our profits to grow kind of business. Yep. When we started Vedantu, we, for the first 2-3 years, we had put our own money in it and burnt it all. Got a bit of money. Remember I told you from B2B to B2C transition, we ended up giving source code to all the players who were using us. Yeah. That also gave us some money to sustain us for almost 7-8 months.
Okay.
We raised our first fund in 2015, I think mid. By then, you know, at least all our fundamental questions got answered. And we were pretty confident that, yes, learning can happen this way, but scale was a problem. We really didn't understand scale at all. It took us 2-3 years more to understand the scale, but Excel really trusted us, has been a very, they've really trusted us all throughout in this journey. But frankly, we raised money when we at least understood that this thing works at an academic level, if not at a scale level.
Fair point.
Raise money, not at idea stage. Kuch to level ka PMF leke aao before you raise money. Raise seed fund in the PMF phase. But venture capital, only after you have understood a bit of your segment.
Got it. Fair point. I think from the startup bit, I think we're jumping right into the product. Most of our audience is PM. So understanding more about the product. So as we get started, I think it's good to understand your users better. I think you spoke about impacting tier 2, tier 3 cities. So a lot of times we see that, you know, these students earlier were going to offline places to study. And now they've transitioned to Vedantu or your competitors, which are predominantly online. So what is this change in user behavior pattern that you've seen? Any interesting things you could cover, stuff like, you know, completion rates or, you know, you mentioned the top 5 jo rank wale hai, but how do you see the batch entirely progressing. So top wale, yes, they might progress yahan pe bhi, aapke app pe bhi, and they will progress on, say, an offline center also. But how do you look at every individual? Or is that something, how is Vedantu solving that?
So if I got your question correct, so children from, you know, now, over the years, increasingly students from tier 2, tier 3 towns have started coming in.
Yeah.
So, and over the years, we've also iterated our product accordingly. We have continuously kept decreasing the prices from being 1-to-1, which was almost 500, 600 rupees an hour, to today, the product being less than 50 rupees an hour, 1/10 of the price, right? Two, our also run lots of modular courses. So today, like a couple of years back, we only used to have 2-year courses, 1-year courses. Today we have, you know, 1-day, 5-day, 10-day, a topic kind of courses as well. So that student can learn or bridge their gaps. For example, there are two types of children that we have. One, who primarily depend on Vedantu for their entire learning, right? So that is around 30-40% of the kids, especially in your 9 to 12th grades, right? In junior grades, it's mostly primary because they hardly go for tuitions otherwise, right? So the kids who come to us primarily, they totally depend on us. The larger portion of them today is coming from actually smaller towns because they don't have access to the good offline substitutes as well, plus cost is a factor for them. In bigger cities, a lot of students are going to, you know, these very established offline players, and many of them come to us to bridge the gap because, you know, they don't get the best teacher at times, they don't understand properly, so they want, you know, additional support. So for them, at times they don't take the entire course, like a 1-year course, but they take, you know, modular courses. Ki mujhe coordinate geometry nahi samajh mein aaya, so let me understand coordinate geometry. So that is how we are trying to evolve to understand different use cases among different segment of students and create products and services accordingly to help them. The whole idea is that provide them amazing service so that they develop enough trust over the time to completely depend on Vedantu.
Nice. Right? What is the current split looking like? Very like approximate who are taking these modularized versus the entire thing with Vedantu?
So I think primary use cases, approximately, as I said, around, you know, in between 30-40%.
Nice. Got it. Yeah, I think that gives us a fair idea. I think it's an evolving market. So thanks for sharing.
It will take a lot. See, education is not a very, as I said, transactional product, right? Ki mujhe zarurat hai to maine le liya. You need a lot of trust building will happen over the time. People will start understanding, achcha, oh, aise bhi padhai ho sakti hai. The success stories will evolve. Word of mouth will spread. So it will take time. So COVID is a blip, I agree. COVID has suddenly glamorized edtech, but I think it's a deep play. It's not that, you know, 6 months ka COVID will make edtech the hero. Though in the investment world, it might have become in the eyes of the investors and everybody, which a lot of people give a lot of value to. But trust me, it will require tremendous amount of real value creation where every child and every family can trustfully believe and see that their child improves on by learning in the online way, then only it will actually penetrate to a very, very deep level. So there is a lot of work to do.
Absolutely. Thanks for sharing that.
Yeah. So Pulkit, actually, it's great that you brought up COVID as well. I did have a question around that. Of course, something that the audience had asked itself. So basically, of course, COVID has increased maybe the users probably shifting from offline to online education as such. And edtech is growing so fast, right? You can see a lot of companies hitting very big valuation numbers as such. You can see the user base increasing as such. You can see some very big exits too, which we had recently. Yes. The question I had is, when edtech is growing, right? Around edtech, for all the entrepreneurs out there, what do you think are the different products that can grow around this particular space? For example, right from the top of my head, what I can think is, let's say Kahoot, right? A quizzing platform. Let's say Zoom itself, where you host your services. What are the services that you think would actually grow along with EdTech when EdTech grows so much?
So say top three ideas.
अपन ये देखा था ना अभी फॉर एग्जांपल सो इफ यू लुक एट द एंटायर लाइफ साइकिल ऑफ अ इन एजुकेशन राइट सो देयर आर सो मेनी थिंग्स दैट हैपन राइट सो देयर इज अ कंटेंट देयर इज अ कंटेंट प्ले देयर इज अ टीचिंग लर्निंग प्ले देयर इज गेमिफिकेशन प्ले देयर इज पर्सनलाइजेशन प्ले देयर इज डेटा प्ले राइट देयर इज इंटीग्रेशन प्ले सो every this step you will see a lot of amazing companies evolving right so if we look at for example US so there is a very there is a famous company called Newton K Newton right this it spells like K Newton so that company operates in the field of data where they built a layer which can be used by anybody to build personalization right then there is a company I remember Clever in US So in the US, the school educational data is very nicely structured. So this company helps other educational service providers and content providers to tap into structured school data, usage data, and help them personalize their content accordingly, right? So for example, we saw Doubtnut, right? For example, which got acquired by Baiju. So they have built a product where they help solving the doubts. For example, coding has become a big product in itself, right? So all these small aspects of entire learning journey of a student, one, will have very interesting and deep companies emerging in my mind, right? There will be big brands as well, which will either use this or build their own layers to provide the entire service as well, right? For example, Vedantu probably is trying to operate in that layer, right? And then there will be lots of tools which will also evolve, right? To help teachers to create better content, to help content providers to add community layers to their product. So a lot of these things will evolve. As I'm sure many of you have in this session have tons of ideas around what products can be built. But I'm sure all these things will evolve and become decent size and good companies in themselves. Yeah.
Awesome.
Good. That's interesting. And if you guys are building any of these products, feel free to drop it in the comment section. Or I think Pulkit will share his coordinates towards the end. Feel free to write down. Pulkit, I think one of the other interesting question is around India's education system in general. I think we heard a lot about the NEP. One question here is, on one side, we talk about how it's broken, where everyone's on a rat race, they're running towards rank, they're running over marks, and parents putting so much pressure. On one side, biggest edtech companies are solving, top three edtech companies in India are solving for the test prep market. So where do you think this, where are they actually solving for? Yes, impact at scale, definitely. But if they are also playing an aid to the entire game, where is the middle ground? How do education startups, biggest education startups in India today, how do they change the face of how this entire education system in India works? What are your thoughts on this?
It's a very interesting question, something that has always troubled me. So I always used to grapple with this question, ki yaar a parallel education system hona hi kyun chahiye? Why do we even need a parallel education system, right? Why do we need tutoring for all that matters?
Yeah.
Right? But then over the years, I've tried to understand, there's a lot of socioeconomic play attached to it.
Yep.
So let me start by understanding why tutoring emerges in developing economies like India and China, right? Mm-hmm. So first I used to blame it, then I eventually started understanding it. And then let's try to build a story from there. So think about this. In a country like India, the number of secure jobs are very limited. So if 100 people graduate, the jobs which we think, the society thinks as the secure jobs are these many, right? So people graduate means the 12th board exams. So these board examinations are designed to evaluate children at a certain level, but not work as filtration process. For example, at 99%, you will have 2000 kids. These are not filtrations. These are evaluations, right? But job to itte sahi hai. So this system fails to create a filtration layer because these companies won't take everyone, right? So then comes the college layer. So automatically some colleges evolve through which, the jobs are more secure, right? So from here to here, there automatically emerges a layer of filtration, which we call as test prep, right? And it has evolved in India, it has evolved in any developing economy, wherever jobs are limited, right? So this system or the schooling system is not preparing for this filtration process, so automatically test prep emerges, right? So this, first of all, we need to understand why test prep is there. Chalo, test prep is there, manli baat. But let us also think, which, do we only teach kids for physics, chemistry, maths, bio in test prep, right? Let us ask all of us who are sitting here, how many of you really use calculus in your daily lives, in whatever that you do? Do you use calculus? Do you use benzene ring? We don't, right? Yeah. Then why on earth did we learn that? So this is a question which was a question in front of me in 2008, and I had a midlife crisis. It was a math class when I was teaching calculus. After the class, suddenly this thought came and I was like, bomb. My entire identity crisis happened. Why am I teaching? So now let us try to understand the perspective, how I think about it. Yep. See, we cannot fight the system beyond a point. So when you build a system, you first adhere to the system so that you are adopted. But what you do in that is the real difference. So then my thought was, why am I teaching calculus? Yep. See, I understood that calculus is not what I'm teaching. I'm teaching those attributes of life and thinking which the child and all of you will use in your lives. For example, there always be situations in your life where you'll think, I have some problem, but you're not able to define that problem, right? So can you really define a problem? If you can define a problem, can you actually go about approaching it in a very objective and a scientific way, like you approach a calculus problem, right? There will always be a lot of pressures in life, societal pressure, peer pressure, financial pressure, emotional pressure. Can you remain calm and composed in all those pressures? Right? Can you remain happy? And can you remain very objective in the way you solve and go about it? I think this is what a good education system and a good teacher teaches in the process of teaching whatever that he or she is, or that system is teaching, right? Because we have to create human beings who can learn, unlearn, relearn, right? Ab mere paas agar wo test prep ke through karne ka opportunity, I'll do that. If tomorrow the policy system emerges and a place like Vedantu can actually become schools in themselves, why not, right? But understand the scenario, go and adhere yourself to that scenario so that you get adopted. Once you get adoption, then go about changing the system is the approach in my mind as I take, right? I cannot just fight it out by sitting in one corner. I will not be adopted to begin with. Yeah. That's how I think. I may be wrong, guys. It's just my personal
view. Absolutely. Absolutely. Thanks for sharing that.
Yep. So, Pulkit, that is actually wonderful. Yeah, it actually makes me think as well. You have a great philosophy behind how Vedantu operates or should also operate as well. But for most students to actually come to Vedantu, you have to get the word out to a lot of public, right? So I have always wondered why this happens, essentially. If you look at the marketing that's done by Vedantu, some other players as well, you see that certain celebrities are roped in to actually do the marketing. In terms of consumer products, I totally understand why celebrities do marketing. They are kind of associated to any consumer products, just like us. But if you look at education, somehow the person who's the, you know, face of Vedantu, perhaps a celebrity as such, isn't really related to education in any way. So I just wanted to know your take on how, you know, this marketing strategy works, of course, and also, does this actually increase your user base in any way? Whom does it target? Does it target the buyer, that's the parent, or is it going to target the user who's a child? So I know it's two questions, but just wanted to know your take on this.
So to begin with, do I really understand it? No. These are all experiments to begin with, right? So we experimented with it. For example, but we tried to connect it with the education. For example, we had a session with Deepika Padukone on mental health, because she runs an NGO there, right? It definitely got us a big amount of traffic. I think almost 1.5 to 2 lakh students attended that session. Our servers also broke in the process. If we do the marketing calculations, how many of them stayed, how many of them actually then took a free live class, academic class, you know, ROI did get justified, but is that the only way of looking at it? We're also emerging. We're also learning it, right? So I frankly have, it's a very recent phenomena for us as well. So I will be wrong in prescribing or saying that, you know, I totally understand it and this is the approach to go for, but open to the experiments here.
Right, yeah.
No, Prakash, frankly, I don't have very deep understanding of it. I think none of us have.
Always had this doubt, that's about it. Anyways, thanks Pulkit.
Yeah, no, great question. I think Akash and I had that, so thanks for asking. And Pulkit, yeah, I mean, we're also just trying to understand the business behind it, how it works. So we're seeing a lot of brands using this as a strategy. So it could be trust building because, you know, users already from, you know, smaller cities, from tier one cities as well.
The one way to look at it is brand, right? So when such people associate with you, so psychologically your brain, you know, starts recognizing you as an established brand, right? So that definitely is one of the aspects. Right. But I think with time, we will also understand that, is it really the case? Is it really the case?
Yep, absolutely.
Because as Akash said, that many of these are not our brand ambassadors, right? So there is no continuity. So is it just a blip of traffic, or is it really, does it really lead to sustained business? Is again the discussions and the experiments that we are having. So far, so good.
Got it. Awesome. Pulkit, we have a bunch of more questions, but we'll just take one from our set and then move to the audience Q&A, the time paucity.
Sure.
So I'll club two questions into this. You spoke about how, you know, you've been evolving, you've been pivoting, and you've grown from B2B to one-to-one, one-to-many, now live and, you know, impact at scale. You mentioned there were very few people doing it back then, but two main things, like how do you see the transition of offline players transitioning to what Vedantu is doing today? Maybe, you know, a hybrid model, or, you know, just bring the online engagement layer. And second, no topic of online education can be complete without talking about the Chinese ecosystem. So I think a lot of your investors also from there, but I'm pretty sure, you know, a lot of learnings that you've got from that ecosystem, you know, live learning. There are unicorns, that I think 11, 12 unicorns, 8, 9 who have already IPO'd, so huge companies. So just wanted to understand your perspective on both these sides of, you know, are offline players transitioning to something what Vedantu and the others are doing, and how do you see that? And what is their challenge? So that bit. And second, what are your biggest learnings from the Chinese ecosystem?
Got it. So yeah, so definitely, you know, I'm actually seeing a lot of offline players transitioning to online. COVID definitely had led to a knee-jerk reaction there as well. So eventually everyone would have come, but because of COVID, everyone now has to come, right? So so definitely the live online bit will become like, matlab ye to hota hai, education matlab live to hai, is the kind of thing that will happen. So it definitely is going to be a competitive field, but the deep work here is the real key, right? So with all of our experiences of being in this field for the last 5-6 years, we know that, you know, just having a teacher sit in front of the class is not enough. There is a lot of data play, there is a lot of product play, there is a lot of service layer play, which goes behind to make learning really happen for a child, right? So yes, offline will definitely come online, but, you know, they will require, everybody will require a lot of deep work for the learning to become predictable at scale. So that's a big challenge that everybody will face. The second problem, that if I tell you the biggest problem of education is CAC, customer acquisition cost. So acquiring a student in education is very, very difficult, because we are talking about a trust-driven conversion, right? It's not like I go on the street and say, ki, chalo, aaj 100% discount mein mil raha hai, aajao. So people will come and take learning, right? Are toffee thodi hai? You're getting what I'm saying? It's a very deep decision for a family. So first, reaching out to target audience, building the right brand, and then eventually converting them takes a lot. So that is again a big challenge that a lot of offline players will face, which they will find ways to. For example, at Vedantu, we have very big distribution network. So for example, as I said, some, you know, 15 million odd people attending our classes on YouTube every month, some 15, 20 million visitors on our ecosystem across app and web properties, right? For example, last month, almost 1 million students took at least a live class on the platform. So this is what we call as distribution, and we are working more around it. So organic distribution is going to be a big, big step for everybody to reduce their costs and make a prudent business at scale. Yeah, so that is what everybody will have to go through. Offline players need to learn this thing very quickly because they don't come from this background. Now coming to the China question, yeah, China is of course insane. My first exposure to China was in 2018.
Okay.
2017 was a time when we were on the brink of closure.
Okay. So,
बहुत सारी चीजें भी है रास्ते में. So some interesting story sometime later. Yeah. But yeah, that is when I went to China to see what चल क्या रहा है. And there's a time when we had started doing group classes as well. So in China at that time I saw that the live started there around the same time when we started it in India, 2014. But by then it had become huge. So in China, in K-12 there are I think some 9-10 unicorns if I'm not wrong. The biggest being Tel is one of our investors as well. We really connected them with them because the founder was a teacher like us before. So teacher connect acha tha. So but I think they are listed on US stock exchange for $25 billion odd market cap. Huge. What is to learn from there is if anybody is looking at education in India, you should definitely study China because you will find all permutation and combinations of products there.
Right.
And it is very deep, and their ability to do it at scale is phenomenal. So they bring that manufacturing precision and execution precision in everything that they do at scale. That is something to learn from China. And another thing to learn from there is their investments in AI.
Yep.
Phenomenal. I mean, very deep work. Very deep work. In AI there. In India, still AI is still a thing of fantasy. Ki haan, meri company mein bhi AI hota hai, aap aa jao. It's a buzzword, right? To sell yourself. But in China, AI is the real differentiator in the business for these companies. Many of them are operating at a scale of 400 million app downloads.
Wow.
The top three companies have almost 400 million app downloads individually. Wow.
And what do you think is stopping India there? Is it the talent? Is it the data availability?
Two, three things, sir. India is evolving here. India probably, okay. I see India is where China was in 2016, 15, 16.
Interesting.
Right?
Interesting.
Yeah, their middle class is huge, humongous. Uh-huh. Right? So businesses grow very fast. When you grow very fast, you have access to money, you have access to talent. Right? Uh-huh. Their ecosystem is very evolved. Their product tech ecosystem is much more evolved than India's because of the size and the breadth of the companies there, right? Mm-hmm. So all those factors come together. We are evolving as a country, but
absolutely.
Economically, we just can't compare ourselves to China. So it's unfair to compare.
Got
we can
it.
Learn, but yeah. We just can't compare. It's
got
too it. Huge economy as compared to India.
Fair point. I think great insights. We should definitely dig deeper into that in another session. But Akash, I think we could pick up some question. Pulkit, how much time do you think you have left?
I came here with time because, you know,
awesome.
I don't want to go without answering questions, as many I get.
Awesome. We'll do, at least we'll pick up a couple of questions from the audience. And if there are more, we could like shoot them out to you after that.
No problem.
Awesome. Akash, we could get started on that.
Yeah, sure. So I've been going through a lot of questions. We've marked some as important from that, at least something that we felt was important. Sorry, guys, if it's biased. But yeah, the latest question, essentially, the one by Abhishek here, is that essentially you do sign up for a lot of online courses, right? But what really happens is that the abandonment rate is really, really high. Yes, Vedantu has a lot of access to data, but how exactly are you ensuring that students actually complete these courses and they don't really abandon it midway?
So yeah, we're doing a lot of stuff there. राइट सो रिटेंशन इज आवर कोर मेट्रिक राइट एंड रिटेंशन के अंदर आता है द अटेंडेंस एंड द कंप्लीशन एंड एवरीथिंग सो एज वी नो एज कम्पेयर टू मूक्स बिकॉज वो भी कहीं पे क्वेश्चन था सो मूक्स में वी हैव सीन द कंप्लीशन रेट्स आर वेरी पुअर राइट अराउंड 10 to 11% especially in the zones where we understand the tangibility people like us also don't complete where we understand the tangibility right ki acha degree milegi naukri achi lagegi so young kid that doesn't understand tangibility at all right so what do we do to ensure that the kids go through the journey so as I said we have one multiple teacher model in our class it's not just one teacher but multiple teachers who help you know involve the kids through multiple strategies one Then post class, we have communities. We have lots of personalized nudges to the children, right? We have the parent involvement as well, and we have mentors assigned to every child. So not it's not one to one. For example, one mentor can have say you know n number of students, but using data, we are trying to build our data systems in such a way that the mentors get the right. Get the right problem statement for a particular child on which the he or she has to then intervene on top of with time we will definitely automate a lot of these interventions as we understand them right so the whole approach of Vedantu is going ahead using technology either we increase the impact of every human being 1000x So can one mentor reach out to 1000 kids, not say 50, not say 200? You need more precise data for it, right? Agree? Second, how can I remove humans from the picture in multiple areas? For example, for doubt solving, why do I need human? I have so much data today, right? So stuff like that. So this is how we are using data to ensure that in simple words, we nudge a child at the right point using the right lever for him or her to continue in the learning journey. Right.
Yep. Makes sense. Thank you so much for that, Pulkit.
Absolutely. Bunch of questions that I've just been going through, trying to club a couple of them. Okay. A lot of them asking, how is Vedantu adapting to the new education policy that was recently released? So what are your top three takeaways and where do you see that a market might emerge here, which is untapped?
So this NEP is path-breaking. NEP will take a lot of time to get executed. So we are keenly observing it, reading it, understanding it. But very positive points there. For example, there is a lot of focus on you know holistic development of children. There is a lot of talks about you know not just focusing on the core subjects but languages and you know other skills. So from Vedantu's perspective, though. A lot of people see us as test prep player, but that is just 50% of our business. Rest is, you know, our pre-10th, right? And we are growing pretty aggressively there. K-12, we do tons of sessions on, for example, languages, music, parenting sessions, right? Coding classes. So we do a lot of these things to evolve a child holistically, right? And we are also trying to So as I said, our core mission statement is impact at scale. Impact means predictable learning outcomes. As we are going ahead, we are trying to question the definition of learning outcome. Why should learning outcome only mean improvement in marks, right? Yeah. Why is learning outcome not in, should we not talk about collaboration as a skill that we should teach a child? Should we not talk about empathy? As something that should, you know, be evolved in a young human brain and heart, right? How can we create a pedagogy which, you know, enhances these aspects? For example, are our classes very collaborative in nature, or are we doing some program or workshop where we are teaching collaboration to the kids? So these are the directions in which we are slowly trying to evolve, as well, because now we, as I said, now we have. Decent attention of the families that we touch.
Right.
So probably our ability to influence them in these ways probably will also be there. So we are very keen and very, very excited about that. And this NEP is actually going in the direction. Right? Yeah. But studying it, पूरा ढंग से हमें समझ में नहीं आया, वी आर ट्राइंग टू स्टडी इट एज वेल एज वी स्पीक.
करेक्ट, राइट. सो Pulkit, adding to that, because you mentioned that you've touched a lot of families, there's a question on the same front, and as you know, can you talk about the challenges of customer acquisition, you know, right from the proof of concept to the initial traction to what it is today, and you know, if you could speak about conversion rates as well, that would be wonderful.
So okay, so I'll talk about the funnel, how the conversions happen on Vedantu. Right, so what happens is in 2015-16 we understood that, you know, live is not a category, so nobody will search for it on Google. Right, if nobody searches for it, then my digital ads will also not work, because what search will I intersect? So there is a time when we started building our SEO strategy, right, which has worked over the years. So it has led to getting, you know, decent amount of traffic. So we get some 15 million plus visits every month on our web app ecosystem. So that becomes our primary funnel. We also have a lot of traffic on YouTube kind of platforms, right? So from there also we try to, you know, get them to our product pages. Now what we try to do from traffic, we try to engage them. So we have lots of properties of engagement. For example, we have, you know, the content properties, we have free live classes, we have lots of videos, free videos, and stuff like that to engage kids, to help them solve their academic requirements, which are not very deep in nature. So I'm not asking for deep commitment here. Those properties which don't ask for huge commitment, but still engages kids because it's their requirement. Doubt asking, videos, free live classes, topic learning, concept learning, bookcase solutions and stuff like that, live quizzes, right? So once they engage, then kicks in our lead scoring mechanism, which right. is the product language that all of you guys use, right? With lots of experiments, yeah. we know that, you know, which students have now understood Vedantu deep enough so that they can trust us to another level by purchasing something, right? So we are evolving with product-based conversions, but a lot of that nudge here is human-based still today. So we have Salesforce, which is on foot to the telecalling team. On foot to kya khatam ho gaya. So it is all online demo based teams today, right? So they nudge them, nudge their families, and then they convert. So this is the entire flow, right? So different grades, different channels, different platforms have different types of conversion rates in this
right.
funnel, right? So that is how we go about it. And then we measure LTV CAC. So post conversion, you have a CAC,
yep.
right? And Vedantu is not a transactional platform. There is a LTV, right?
Yep.
So
yep.
we understand our retention numbers also, which builds our LTV calculation. So yep. then we measure okay. LTVs to CAC, which should be healthy enough. Right? This is how we go about, you know, analyzing whatever that we do.
Absolutely. I think you've simplified it a lot. I'm pretty sure it's a lot more complex, but no specific numbers there. How has this impact of COVID really been? Has it reduced your entire CAC? Has it increased LTV? What is the impact of COVID in terms of percentages? No specific numbers.
So COVID has definitely decreased the CAC.
Yeah.
Right? Because it's obvious.
Yeah.
Because people, they don't have much choices today. They're yeah. coming in at big numbers. Yeah. Right? But this COVID has also led to breaking a lot of our systems. Our systems, frankly, were not designed to handle yeah. this scale, right? So a lot of systems also broke in the process. So all those things happened. But just to simplify your the answer,
yeah,
the reduction in cost happened mm-hmm. because of the COVID situation. And in many places, we saw our traffic increasing to the tunes of 5x to 10x as well. Right.
Oh, that's interesting. That's interesting. Mostly organic, or was there any particular interesting GTM that you thought of? Okay, now this is situation. Anything that you could share?
Majority is organic, but this is a time when we also started doing branding activities as well.
Yeah. Right?
So yeah. that also led to the increase in traffic.
Deal. For sure. I think Pulkit, questions are coming in as we are trying to close Lots. A lot of them, but we're getting yeah. Even more. So we'll do one thing, Pulkit. I think we've cross time a lot more. Yeah, we'll probably we'll close with one or two more questions. And we'll probably send you a list of these. So in case you're active on any of your social media platforms, if you could pick these up, we could do like an AMA on Twitter and continue there. So Akash, maybe we'll do one each. And I think he will be sharing his coordinates at the end. So Pulkit, I think one more bunch of questions that are interesting is, like you spoke, I think in your case, the decision maker is very different. So the one who pays for the product is different. The one who uses the product is different. So any interesting ideas around that you've seen on how do you go about, conveying this message and in the right way, in an ethical way?
Also the user research wise, Pulkit, if you could help. I mean, do you like drop think about ideas. It from, yeah.
So the Vedantu actually is, we actually operate in multiple categories. So K-12 is not a singular category. So test prep, for example, is 10th to 12th, majorly, right?
Yeah.
Behaves very differently. Their consumer, everywhere is a child, right? But the child is a big decision maker also, right? So in the entire test prep segment, be it IITJ, need to beyond, like bank PO exams and everywhere, the consumer is a big influencer. Right. And a lot of decision making hangs onto him or her. Agar ek 11th ka bachcha bolta hai, if 11th grader says that, I really want Vedantu, then parents actually go about that child, what the child wants. So a lot of a product buildup in that zone happens keeping child in the mind, not just as consumer, but also as customer, right? Mm-hmm. Final nudge definitely needs to happen to the parent, but the decision-making to a large extent is influenced by the student is what we have seen. But as we go below the grades, right? Yeah. It is all parent. So while building the product layers, right? We try to build it in such a way that, the parent is seeing it, the parent is interacting with it, and parent in the process is bringing the child to experience it. If the experience is not working out for the child, it's a clear no, right? But that is the role of child. Child's role is to objectively say no to it. Are you getting what I'm trying to say, right?
Yeah.
All the flows are built keeping parents in mind. And once the classes start, then we try to build it keeping child in the mind and keeping parent in the loop, right? So this is how we try to build the product. In K-5 is a very different plane altogether again. So it's very high on parent. Yep. Parent hi bachche ko bithata in the class itself, but the class and all the interactions are built specifically for the child, but all other layers are built for the parent, keeping the parent in mind and their age groups in mind.
Right. So far, I think it's mainly test prep K-12 market, but are you also looking at upskilling as a market?
Post 12
professional courses, is it?
So, see, as I said, in someday we definitely will go there, but in the near future, no, because we already have a lot on our plate, and as evolving, we are seeing that we're actually grappling with not one but multiple products in house.
Yeah.
Test prep, middle grades, K-5, all three are very different products in themselves. So very different product flows, product journeys, types of classes, interactions, type of content, the role of content, everything is different. Acquisition funnels. So we are deciding to focus here majorly, right? Yep. And as we talk, K-12 is the biggest pie, right? The pyramid goes like this.
Yep. 50
million kids are in K-12. So that's what we are.
But that's from a market perspective, but just wanted to understand that from a Vedantu perspective as well. How much percentage of it would be just the school education and what would be test prep for you?
It's almost 50-50.
All right. Got it.
Nice. Because as we come towards the end of this, a lot of our folks who are in early stages or mid-stage PMs already, is there any hiring plug? Is Vedantu hiring product managers today? And if so, what are the top three challenges that you were trying to solve so that if they reach out to you, they can reach out to something specific, how they can help you solve those problems?
Insider information.
So yeah, definitely we are actively hiring in product design, as well as tech, And as I said, you know, the problems are very deep now. So as you said, see, Vedanta is completely running on a huge layer of product. So let me put it this way. Vedanta has two broad layers. One is growth, one is service. Now this growth is, you know, building the traffic, engaging them, cataloging, discovery, sale, conversion, right? This is e-commerce. Think of it like an e-commerce, but more complicated than e-commerce, because in e-commerce, I know mujhe Xiaomi ka phone chahiye. I'll go compare purchase. At Vedantu, the product needs to explain to a point that it builds the trust. It attacks and it solves so many problems for a child. In the process, that child and the family, you know, understands the value proposition and the quality, right? The exploration, the discovery, and the conversion. It's a very big problem statement. Think of it like an e-commerce, but simply put, for all the product folks here. But where e-commerce stops, that is where the real product journey of Vedantu starts, right? Every day, every child engages on the platform for almost, you know, 2 hours plus. You know, that is very deep. Live classes, post-class content, in-class content, testing, subjective, objective, doubt solving after the class, community layers, parent-teacher meetings, building product from the student side, from the teacher side, from the parent side, massive ops layer, right? Because think about launching hundreds of courses every day, provisioning content inside it, building tons of content in the process, classifying them, making them discoverable and adaptive, right? Managing the schedule and the student's life journey. How do I build product to train my teachers? Can it be mathematical? Right. So there are so many challenges at hand right now.
If you could help us with top two challenges, so that at least when the,
Personalization.
For students, right? Personalized learning journey.
Very deep layer for students.
Uh-huh.
One.
Yeah. Right?
Second is interaction. Making
learning process
super interactive at massive scale.
Got it.
1000 bachche ki class hai, but still can it be super interactive and personalized for each and every child?
Nice.
Right? And third is distribution. That is, can we build products which really catches fancy of each and every child so that they engage with the platform free of cost?
Very interesting.
Right?
Very interesting.
So distribution, interaction, personalization are my three very big problems.
Awesome. I think that's great. So guys, in case anyone's interested in the edtech space, I think very clearly put, I don't think a lot of founders put out, you know, what they're trying to solve in the current moment. So yeah, I think this is a great place to, you know, start for you guys. And with that, I think Akash, do you want to add something? Because Pulkit, I thoroughly enjoy education as a space. So it was enriching for me.
One or two more problems, because I was seeing
please do.
A lot of
please
problems do, are around, you know, from Nikhil.
No, absolutely. Please do.
You know, some more people talking about the role of content. Rishabh, right?
Please go ahead, yeah.
So yes, guys, there's a lot of... So as I said, you know, learning is not just about class only. Right? So learning happens outside the class a lot. So there is a massive role of content at Vedantu. So we invest a lot on content. Content has multiple directions. One is in-class content. So as I said, we are not a marketplace. We curate the content. We build it with our teachers. We iterate it. We measure it through data. But in-class content is one. Second, post-class content, that is videos, tests, assignments, small snippets to help some problems. All these are very big areas for us and big areas of innovation for us as well. So many of you are talking about, you know, interactive content. Yes, that is something that we are looking at. We're also looking at gamifying the content, right? Because we are learning that gamification has a humongous role to play in education, pushing the child in a positive way. So yeah, so I hope I could briefly answer.
Yep, absolutely. If there is any other that you'd like to pick from this set, I think a bunch of them, but I think we'll be sure to share these questions with you. I think Zoom records it, so we'll take that question set and we'll share.
So guys, I'm sharing my email ID. Please feel free to email me as well.
Yep.
Right? I'm on LinkedIn. You can message me on LinkedIn as well, right? I will try my best to answer your questions.
Awesome. Right.
Would love to discuss. I mean, in general, I love to brainstorm, right? If anybody is open to brainstorming, please ping me. Because yaar, mujhe aadhe questions ke answer khud hi nahi pata hai. So, I may be very biased in the way I'm approaching, right? So when I have discussions with people like you, I really get to understand a lot.
Thanks so much, Pulkit. Thanks so much for being like frank and real about it. And I think that's where we get to learn a lot. With that, I think we still have over 60, 70 attendees with us. We're still, I think I lost count of how long this went through, but I thoroughly enjoyed it. And
rating kiti hai, so in our classes
NPS
how many dropped during the
guys, if you like the session, we don't have a interactive thing here, but please feel free to like take screenshots and like put out a tweet or a LinkedIn post and share genuine feedback what you'd like to see next. I think we do these weekly sessions, so whatever you liked about it or what do you think we should improve. It can be specific to this session. It can be for the community. It can be for Pulkit. Like what you like, then what you'd like to hear, we could do, you know, a part two if you really liked it. And yeah, we'd love to hear from you guys. With that, I think Pulkit, thanks so much once again for joining us. We'll
definitely. But a great initiative, guys. Akash shared, you know, some previous sessions videos with me, and I thoroughly enjoyed going through them and learned a lot. So it's a great initiative, guys. Product, I think, is a new field for India. I mean, itta 10 saal purana hoga max. And we all are learning together. So knowledge sharing really helps. And I've seen that, you know, ecosystem is so open to share. I'm really glad that, you know, whenever I go to these stellar product guys and founders to ask anything, they've always helped me so well. So never shy away from, you know, reaching out and asking as well. People are very open these days to share. Right.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Just to end that session, guys, we've launched a new thing called GrabChai.online, which is essentially helping you connect one-to-one with other people, other interesting people off the internet. So you might just want, if you have like half an hour or 1 hour where you'd like to meet interesting people in a similar domain, do check that out. We're launching a new initiative again through the Product Folks, going live this evening. I think it might already be out. It was supposed to be 5 p.m. I think we overshot, but do check out our LinkedIn pages, Twitter handles. I think this is something big for us. We've been doing these events for 15 months now. We've done 100 plus. But yeah, this is a culmination of all that effort. So do check it out. And with that, thanks so much once again, Pulkit. And we'll definitely connect with all
thanks
you guys.
Thanks a lot, guys. Thoroughly enjoyed. Bahut maza aaya. Thanks for having me. And wish you all the very best, all of you. You know,
thanks,
be happy always.
Thank you so much.
The real success in life is, you know, main bachcho ko bolta hu, bol raha hu, don't mind me. So this graph is y equal to x square, right? This is the real success in life. This smile on your face. Jo bhi karo life mein, whatever that you do, just never forget to smile. Rest, everything else is all the jargons, right?
Absolutely. Everything else is secondary. Happiness is first for sure.
Yeah. Cool. Okay, guys. Bye. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Pulkit.
See you. Thanks so much, guys, for joining.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Bye. Happy Independence Day.
Happy Independence Day.
We want to do this in the beginning, but just remember. Yeah. Have a great day, guys. Have a great weekend. And see you next week. Bye.
See you, guys. Bye-bye. Thank you, Pulkit.